This is business mathematics in the statistics and it's a continuation of knowledge area one. Today we are going to be introduced with the lecture number two. And this knowledge area one is consisting two or three lectures, lecture one, lecture two, and lecture three. We'll be covering the knowledge area one. And today you have lecture two, which is lecture of functions. The function is the second lecture from the first topic that you had in lecture one concerning set. And now this is the second part of it, whereby at the end of this lecture you will have to be able to use the ordered pair and sketch Cartesian diagram. Again, you have to identify the dependent variable and independent variable. The third part you are supposed to understand and identify the domain and range of a given function. The other thing, you will be able to sketch the graph of the relations, functions, linear, quadratic, together with the polynomial functions. And finally, you will be able to find out the inverse of each of the relation together with the how to sketch the inverse of those relations. Now, for the first part, we have set production. For the set production, we say, given that when you have two sets, A and B, and now these two sets can be having the element. For instance, you have set A is element 2, 3, and 5, and set B has element 1, 3, and 4. Now, when you are asked to find out the set production of these two sets, what we are supposed to do is now to have the combination or all elements being written one after another. As you can see on the web example, there A cross product B contains the element of 2,1, 2,3, 2,4, 3,1, 3,3, 3,4, 5,1, 5,3, continuously. You take the first element from the first set, then you cross with all elements in the second set. Then you take the second element of the first set, then you cross with all elements in the second set. Finally, you take the third element of the first set, you cross with all elements into the second set. So if you take 2, you have to cross with 1, 3, and 4. If you take 3, you cross it with 1, 3, and 4. Again, if you take 5, which is the third element from the set 1, you have to cross it with all elements in the second set, which is 1, 3, together with 4. Now, if we present this into the Cartesian diagram, it means we have to sketch the vertical line together with the horizontal line, whereby the ordered pairs will be created from all elements of set 1 and the other element in set B. Set 1 will be allocated along the horizontal line and set B is being allocated along the vertical line. And now you can have the ordered pair, which are 2,1, 2,3, 2,4. Again, you have 3,1, 3,3, 3,4. Again, you have 5,1, 5,3, and 5,4. That is A cross product B. And also, you can have B cross product A, of which now element along the horizontal line won't be those of set A again, will be those of set B, and element along the vertical line will be those of set A. That is Cartesian diagram on how to present these ordered pairs. And now, to the second part, we have relations of these sets. Relations of the sets, for instance, if you have set A and set B, we say this can be defined as any subset of ordered pair that have been created from the two sets. These two sets are, for instance, set A corresponding to set B, whereby we have ordered pairs. Now, from these ordered pairs, all elements from the first set, which are normally written on the horizontal line, we say are known as domain. While all elements into the second set, of which now they are coming from the vertical line, these are what we call codomain. And in fact, they are known as range. And we say all elements into the vertical line that are images from the first set are what we call range, whereby all the shapes of the first element are also what we call the range. And now, if you can present these two sets into the pictorial presentation, you can have now the overlap structure which contains elements 2, 3, and 5. Again, you can have the other element B that contains 1, 3, and 4, and the second element are known as range, which we call codomain, whereby the first set are known as domain. You can see all elements into the second set are images of the first set. Now these are what we call range, whereby all elements of which they are subjected or they are coming from set B are also known as domain. So you can have the example there. For instance, if you say the relation R is given by the set of ordered pair 0,2, 0,4, and 1,2, 3,5. These three sets, we say, they are also can be written into the pictorial presentation, or else we say the first element, which are 0, 1, and 3 of the ordered pairs mentioned above, they are domain. And for the second element, without repetition, like 2, 4, and 5, they are known as codomain. Now, if you ask me to find out the domain of these two sets, you say, this domain I define as element of X for sum of Y. Only of those X that give us the value of Y are what we call domain. And all values of, always say the element of X that is also having reflected into the element of Y, we call it as range. As you can see there for the second example, if you are to find the range of the relationship between Y equals 2, 3X exponent 2 plus 2, it means here now, when we say the domain are all elements of X for sum of Y, we mean you have to keep Y the subject, then you find out the value of X of which when subjected to that equation will give us the value of Y. And now, as you can see, if we have Y equals 2, if we have Y equals 2, if we have Y equals 2, three X exponent 2, again you add up with 2, then we have Y being the subject of X exponent 2, any value that you subject here, like 0, will give you the value of Y. Like if you put here 0, exponent 2, we have to end your 0, you add with 2, Y will be 2. If you put here negative 1, you end up with positive 1, you multiply by 3, this will give you 5. So if you put here a number here, like 1 again, or you put it 8, you end up having the value of Y. So we call this any number that we put we subject it to x, we end up with getting the value of y. Now, this is what we say, domain is all real numbers. This all positive, negative number together with zero will give you the value y. And now, if we are looking for the range, we said here from the definition, the range are all elements of y for sum of x. Now, if we say for sum of x, we mean you are supposed to have now x as the subject of this function. So this will end up in plus or minus the root of y minus 2 divided by 3. Divided by 3. Now, if we have that one, x equals plus or minus the root of y minus 2 divided by 3, now we are looking the value that we put here for y, the value of y that will give us x. Now we say here, at your level, now, if we put here negative 2, for instance, you end up on having into the root a negative number. Now a negative number will become a complex number and you don't want it. So for that purpose, we need here to start with number 2 in such a way that 2 will become 2 minus 2 is equal to 0, 0 over 3, the root of 0, it is correct. Or else, if you have 3, you can say 3 minus 2, it becomes 1, 1 over 3. Now we have into the root a positive number. Now we need to have here a positive number into the root so that we can have the value of x. So y will have to be bigger than or equal to 2 so that you have now a number which is positive into the right, into the root. Now we say for that purpose, if we talk about range, we end up with having the value of y which are bigger than or equal to 2 so that you can have a positive number into the root. So we say the range will be all real numbers which are bigger than or equal to 2. Now the other part is how to draw the graph of the relation. And now when you draw the graph of the relation, you have to follow some principles. Follow some principles because the relations have got two sets. And we say in plotting the graph of the relations, you need to choose arbitrarily elements along the horizontal axis over the first set, and now which are the independent variables. Then after you have to get the second set from which are what we call dependent variables. And now the graph of the relation can be also of the equal sign. And now you can have, for instance, if you sketch the graph of R such that y equals to 2x, the word equal there, it means that it is quite a kind of relations. And now we can be asking to find the gradient range after drawing the graph. Then what you do, you are supposed to choose arbitrarily the elements which come from the first set. And now for the table that I've written there, it is x and y, of which now what we are doing there, we are looking for the two points, of which now these two points are enough to sketch a horizontal line. A horizontal line can be drawn, or a linear graph can be loosely drawn by using only two points. And now, if you choose, for example, element 0 from the first set, which now I've called it as x, if we choose 0, we substitute into the equation y equals 2x. Now, 0 into as x, if multiplied by 2, we end up getting 0. So y will be 0. If we substitute 1 as x, now we get y is equal to 2. Now we have two points there 0,0 and 1,2. These 2 points, you can join them with the vertical line, this horizontal line, which are x-axis, and the vertical line, which is y-axis, is now being joined in the line with the cutting with the line, which is y equals to 2x. And now you have drawn already a line of y equals to 2x. Now, if we are asked to look for the domain and range, it means you have to end with the looking. With the looking, when you have something like this, you have to look all elements along the horizontal axis. All element along the horizontal axis. The graph of the relation with equality sign. Now you choose any 2 points from the first set. For instance, here we had y equals 2x, and now you have to write x and y, and now together you have to choose any of the 2 points a bit bigger. For instance, you choose here x becoming 0 as your independent variable. And now if you substitute here 0, you end up y equals 0. And if you choose any number again a bit bigger, for instance, you choose x equals to 1, and now we have 1 times 2, the y becoming 2. So it means here you have the 2 points that have to be plotted into this vertical axis together with the horizontal axis. The 2 points are 0,0 together with 1,2. These are the 2 points, point 1 and this is point 2. And now, after I have drawn this vertical axis, which now we call it y axis, and we have drawn this horizontal axis, of which now we call it x-axis, and we put the elements 1, 2, 3, and so on, depending on how many points you had, and negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, depending on how many the points you had. It means here in between the original point, which is 0,0, and you have also elements along the vertical axis, of which you call it ordinates. And this become 1, 2, 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3 continuously. And now we say you have to plot these 2 points so that you can join the 2 points by using ruler. And now when you put this point, you have to count, start with the first element from the first set. For example, when x is 0, y will be also 0. When x is 0, y becomes 0. So this is the first point. The first point that we put a small x as your first point, x is 0 and y 0. The second point will be x being 1 and y being 2, x being 1 and y being 2 somewhere here. Now it means when x is 1, y is what? 2. So if you connect a line with these 2 points, you end up with having the other line that is connecting those 2 points. And this will become now what? Y equals to 2x. Instead of having this one, we say you have now the line that is connecting the 2 points which you are supposed to sketch as you are given graph. Now, after that, you may be asked to find the domain of this line and the range. Now, when you are looking for the domain of this line, you are supposed to follow the following procedure. You have to follow the following procedure. You have the point here, which is 1,2. The other point 0,0, and now this is your line y equals to 2x, and from there you have the two halves. You have this line with the other half, the other half is on that side. You choose any point from one of these lines here. For instance, you choose element 1 to see whether it's equivalent to the line which I put it on. Again, you choose another element to see, does it found, can you find it into the line? The other point, can you find it into the line? The other point, can you find it into the line? You can see the range is continuous up and down. So it means any element along the horizontal axis, when subjected into the line, you find the trend in the line. So we say all elements of which can be found into this drawn line, we call it as domain. And all the elements that is found into the vertical axis, when connected into the line, you found it into this line that has been drawn, one for 2x, we say all these elements will be the range. Now, for this purpose, all of the positive numbers, all the negative numbers, zeros included, we say they can all be found into this line. So, for that way, is what we call x is domain in the set of x such that x in the set of all the numbers. And also, range will be the set of all real numbers. Since all elements are subjected into this equation, you have a range into the other set. And now we have the 3.2 point, which is how to sketch a graph of inequality. After finishing the graph of inequality, you have to be aware of how to sketch the graph of inequality. For the inequality, you mean you have bigger than, less than, bigger than or equals, and less than or equal signs. And when you have this, you have to follow some steps whereby you are supposed to make sure that before you sketch your graph, what signs you have been subjected to that equation. And now, the equation that I've been given is, for instance, when you have y equals 2, y is bigger than or equal to 2x. That side there, it is bigger than or equal, or greater than or equal to 2. We say that side is means that you have in a quite a kind of equation. Now you have to note that when you sketch graph of inequality, you are supposed to shade one of the half. You are supposed to shade in one of the half, and this half is like I showed you. If you have this line, there is half and the other half. So if you say this is bigger than this, it means one of the half will be shaded as an equal region and the other half will be shaded as the correct or the correct part of the line. And now you can have the example here. Yeah. So when you have to shade for the adjacent region, we say you have to look on the half which is having the point which will substitute it into the inequality given as you have been given there, y is greater than or equal to 2x, will give you the correct answer. That side which has a point which gives you a correct answer, we say it is the correct side, and we say wanted region. The other side which does not give you the correct answer, we say it is unwanted region. And now, after shading and allocating the point, the side which is clear, we call it a wanted region, and the side where you are supposed to state your domain and range. And for that purpose, when you have y bigger than or equal to 2x, we say the domain is also all real numbers, and the range is also all real numbers. Why? It's because any element along the horizontal axis, like when you have 2, 3, and 4, you find they are also being found into the wanted region. And all elements along the vertical axis, as you have there, 1, 2, and 3, if you connect it to the other frame into the rotor axis, you find also there into the water region. Therefore, we say also the range of this equation was also the same as y equals to the set of all real numbers, because any element to substitute there along the rotor axis will have the frame to the vertical axis. And now the other graph is that of the inverse of the relation. The inverse of the relation. The inverse of the relation, it is just the same as the relation we are doing there. The opposite is that all elements which were called as domain will change and become range. And all elements which was range change become domain. So all elements in the first set, instead of being the domain, will become range, and all elements are in the second set, which were the range, will change become what? Domain. That's what we call the inverse of the relation. It's for instance now when you have set R with the ordered pairs A, B, C, D, E, F. Now you can see elements from the first set are A, C, and E, while elements from the second set are B, D, and F. Now, C, A, and E, or say A, C, and E, these are domain for that relation. While B, D, and F are the range. But now, if you go for the inverse of this one, you say all elements which were domain, they become range. All elements which were range, they become domain. As elaborated there, it means that you have inverse of the relation. And now you can be asked to find also the domain and the range of the inverse of the relation. Then when you ask so, it means the first at first what you do, you will have to change. You have to change the position of the variable you had. For instance, see, where you have y equals to 4fc exponent 2. They ask you to find the inverse of this relation. It means they ask you to find this one, the inverse of this relation. This is the relation, and this is its inverse of that relation. Now, we say, when you are looking for the inverse of this relation, we have to check the position of each variable. Change the position of each variables, and now for the equation that we had there, you can have now when you say y equals to 4x exponent 2, it means you have to say y will become x and x will become y. So this will become y exponent 2. After accepting the position here, what we have to do again is to go back and now make y the subject. You make way the subject how? You divide here by 4 and here by 4. This is finished. You end with y exponent 2 equals 2, 4, and the denominator and x there. X over 4. Then you make the root of it the root of it. So you have now y equals 2, that's all minus the root of x over 4. Or we say y equals 2 plus or minus the root of x divided by 2. So this becomes your inverse of this relation. So this will become plus or minus the root of x divided by 2. So it means after having now the second equation is the inverse of this relation. What you do is now to find out the domain and the range of this particular inverse of the relation. Either you can draw into the graph, then you look on the element that belong to the from the first set to the second set, then after you look for the domain and range. And now For that particular equation, we had the domain. We have the domain as the same as all elements which can be bigger than or equal to what? Zero. And the range was all elements which are the images of the what? Of the first set. And that's how. And now, if we continue again to find out, for instance, the inverse of this graph, we find that if we sketch into the x and y axis, we find that the first equation, which was the y equals 4x exponent 2, is a parabola that is a parabolic upward, whereby the inverse of that equation will give you the different graph, which is showing to the right, instead of the, this is the inverse of that equation, whereby you had again as a parabolic upward from the first equation, which was y equals 2, 4x exponent 2. And this is now plus or minus the root of 2 divided by 2. Like that. Root of x divided by 2. And now, if you have such kind of graph, it's very easy now to look how many elements within the horizontal line can you have of them into the vertical line. All those elements that have a frame to the vertical line are what we call the frame. And all elements along the vertical axis that have a frame into this graph and they can be connected to the horizontal line are also what we call the range. And now, this is how now simple can make it, so that you'll be aware on how to get out now the domain equation. For instance, for the inverse of this equation, it means we have only all elements from 0 to the positive, like 1, 2, 3, and so on, as the domain. Because into the negative side, the graph is not there. And for the relation here, you have only element from 0, 1, 2, positive upward for the range, but to the negative side, you don't have the graph. Now, initially, you had this y equals 4x exponent 2, whereby you can say range are all values of y which are bigger than or equal to 0. And here, you can have the domain where all values of x bigger than or equal to what? To 0. Now the other part is on how to go through with the linear function. The linear function, the function that have two variables. The first variable are known as independent variable, and the second variable are known as dependent variables. And these variables can also be used, again, as we said to the previous equations, that can also be used to find out the embedded range. And now for this purpose, we have now another way of writing it, whereby we say, if you, when you are, okay, so we have a linear function. For the linear function, we say, if you have y equals to 3x plus 1. Now, for the function, where this is the function of x as the image of 3x plus 1. So this is the function notation of this equation. We call it function notation. Function notation. Now, for the function notation here, you have been given, for instance, the function of x equals to 2x plus 3 for sum of x of which are, for example, x is equal to 1 and x is equal to negative 2, or can be given x is equal to letter a. Now, when you have the function like this, it means you just substitute the value of x into this function. And you have now the function of x, x being 1, equals to twice as much as 1, and it is 1. So the function of x being 1 will become root of 2, 3 plus 1, and this is equals to what? Equals to 4. So likewise, when you have x is equal to 2, you have to put or substitute x there as 2, and it will become 2 times the negative 2 times 2 becomes negative 4. If you add this 2, it will come with the answer which is negative 2. If you have the letter a, it means it will be the function of letter a equals 2 twice as much as a, you add it with 3. And now this will become the function of a equals 2, 2a plus what? Plus 3. Like that. And that's how. The second example, you can have k, function k, because that is said to become f. K is the function of x equal to 3. Now, if they ask you x is equal to negative 1, it means substitute x as one, negative 1. Now, it becomes the k function k as for negative 1, it becomes equal to what? 3. And the function k into 7 become equals to what? 3. The other part is how to find the gradient and the different forms of the linear function. Gradient and different forms of linear function. When you are sketching graphs, when you sketch a graph, you must be aware of the nature of the graph. Now, we start with the constant graph. For the constant graph, it can straight be drawn because when you are drawing a straight line, it's not necessary to have so many points. You say only 2 points is enough to draw a straight line. And now, for this purpose, you have now constant graph. Constant graph, like when you say y is equal to a, or you say y is equal to 5. 5 is constant. So if we say y is equal to a, it means we have to draw vertical axis and horizontal axis. These are the vertical axis, and now we call this, for instance, x axis, and any number along the vertical axis, say it is 5. If we say we are drawing, for example, y is equal to 5, it means your graph will have to pass around 5. So this will become y is equal to 5. That's why if you say y is equal to a, it means somewhere we have a, and there we have to pass through that a. You have now y is equal to what? A. And if we say y is equal to 0, it means this graph is drawn within the x axis. And this is y is equal to what? 0. If you have again the other constant graph, is when you have x is equal to, say, x is equal to 6, x is equal to 4, or x is equal to b. If you say x is equal to b, it means now where you have elements along the x axis, horizontal axis with the element B, the vertical line will have to be drawn and cut through that element B. If you want to draw, for example, x is equal to 0, it means that the graph is passing through the vertical axis on the y axis exactly. For the negative B, again, the element along the horizontal axis will be negative B, and the vertical line will be drawn cutting through the element negative B. The other edge of the graph is when you have slope being negative or the slope being positive. When I have the slope being positive, the graph also can be above the original. And this is like when you have y equals to mx plus c. And when the graph cuts across the origin, it's when you have, for instance, y is equal to mx. It means there is no intercept. When you have the graph cutting below the origin and passing through the vertical axis, and now we say this is again another kind of equation of the graph with the positive gradient, and this is y equals mx minus c. And it's minus c because the graph is cutting down below the origin at the element which is negative c. If we don't have again the negative slope, it means this graph will lie to the left, and if it is above the origin, it means this will become y equals negative mx. M is the slope of that line, it means that it's lying to the left. You add it with the plus c because this graph is cutting at element c, which is a positive element. And if it is cutting to the original but lying to the left, we say this is y equals mx negative m times x. And if it is cutting through the negative element beyond the origin of the vertical axis, and now we say y is negative m times x minus c. It's minus c because the graph is cutting through the intercept on the y-axis at negative c. And you can have again the other kind of function, what we call quadratic function. Quadratic function are the functions that follow the general equation function of xc equals to ax squared 2 plus ax plus again bx. This is to make sure that the only condition is to make sure that a must be bigger than 0, because the coefficient of a or the x exponent 2, if it is 0, it can no longer become the correct function. Because the correct function, you want the highest exponent of the independent variable to be exponent 2. And now, when you are looking for the time point, as that graph shows there, where the quadratic turns, we say that's the turning point. For the turning point, when you are looking for it, you have to use those variables. The variables have to be drawn from the function that have been given. And now, this variable, when substituted into the general point of the third point, which is, for example, this is for the independent variable to be negative b divided by 2a. For the dependent variable, this will be 4ac minus b exponent 2 over 4a. And now, we say at any point where the graph is turning, for instance, you have the parabolic downward and that one. At this point here, it's what we call x of the turning point, and this is y of the turning point. Now, it means when you are given a function or quadratic equation, you have to look for the coefficient of all variables which are available. Then that coefficient of all variables together with the constant element, like when you have the function of x equals to ax exponent 2 plus bx plus c, it means now you have a, b, and c. These are what you substitute into these elements. The first set will be negative b over 2a, and the second element will become 4ac minus b exponent 2 divided by for any. These are how we control that the turning point of any of the quadratic graph. Otherwise, when you draw, you have to know that when you draw or sketch the quadratic graphs, what you have to utilize is to find the dependent variables arbitrarily. And when you're looking for the dependent variables, it's not like when you draw a line, you must have at least 6 points that you can use it to connect so that you draw a smooth curve. For instance, when you had the equation y equals 2 4x exponent 2, you are supposed to have at least 6 points, starting from 0, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, are the dependent variables, together with 1, 2, 3. From there, you can have your independent variable, your dependent variable y. And now, from this point, it means now you can sketch your graph as you can see it here. When it is negative 1, you have y being positive 4. When, at the table there, when you have negative 1, you have positive 4. When you have 0, you have 0 for dependent variable. Negative 2, again it is positive 16. So you sketch all these points into the same graph that contain x-axis and vertical axis. And now that both graphs can be drawn at that one. Thank you for listening, and this is the end of lecture number 2 for the first knowledge area.